afternoon. Welcome to Security Through Design, Making Security Better by Designing for People. In Mandalay Bay, GH, with Yella Nimad Fardrit. Before we begin, a few brief notes. Stop by the Business Hall, located in Bayside AB, during the day and for the welcome reception from 5:30 to 7 p.m. tonight. The Black Hat Arsenal is on the Palm Foyer on Level 3. Join us for the Pony Awards in Mandalay Bay, BCD, at 6:30. And finally, thank you for putting your phone on vibrate. It makes it easier for the rest of us to ignore the ringing while you wait for your voicemail to pick up. Thank you.
I like to watch the world around me, and I like to observe things and people. And when doing so, I'm very much fascinated by why do things work. You probably all recognize the image on the screen, the London Tube map. Such an iconic image, which does an excellent job of simplifying the transport network. In fact, you could say it's almost a little bit too good, because when people travel in central London and they want to travel from, for example, Oxford Circus to Bond Street, they look at the map and they think, oh, that's one stop on the red line, on the central line. So they go down to the metro for one stop. What the map doesn't show is that in reality, these stations are very close to each other. It is far quicker to just walk on the street level, especially in rush hour when it can take forever to wait for a train. And that's why you see these signs popping up now in London everywhere on the street level. They're essentially simple maps of your immediate surroundings. And the beauty is that they show in circles how much a 5, a 10, or a 15-minute walk would be. And in doing so, encouraging people to consider walking as an alternative. So this is nice. This is something that works almost a little bit too good, you could say. And then on the other end of the spectrum, we have stuff like this. A light switch. How simple can it be? Yet we need explanatory signs to say what is on, what is off, and which button does corresponds to which part of the room. Irony, by the way, I snapped one of these two light switches at the industrial engineering faculty of one of the universities in the Netherlands, so they might have a little bit of homework to do there. But this is all well and good, but what on earth does all this have to do with security? Why should we care about this? I've worked in incident response digital forensics for over 10 years, and when you work in that field, you do see an awful lot of things going wrong, and that especially sparked my interest to further explore these underlying factors, especially when it comes to dealing with human behavior. The humans are the weakest link, or there's no patch for human stupidity. There's even t-shirts with this stuff. We, a little bit pedantic, if you ask me. This notion that we have created this whole environment that's safe and reliable, yet we have all these idiots running around, these users making a mess of everything. There's just a couple of bad apples in the bowl that ruin it for all of us. Pedantic and also plainly wrong, if you ask me. Nobody goes to work with the intention of making a mess of things, even when things might look that way when you look at an incident, something going wrong in hindsight. There's one exception, maybe. There is one person, the Chaos Monkey from Netflix, who, of course, does get paid to screw things up at work. But yeah, let's treat that as an exception for now. Now, it turns out that if you dive into research, into failure in complex environments, such research increasingly puts the ball back into the court of the complex system. What does that mean? That means that if you conclude that an incident is the result of human error, you have essentially not explored the incident deep enough. You need to dig deeper. Human error or a human action can only be a symptom. It's not an underlying cause. There's almost always a systemic failure, an unclarity earlier on in the process that led to somebody doing something that, in hindsight, might look stupid. So please, can we maybe be a little bit more modest in our approach and erase those funny quotes, those funny cartoons from our vocabulary, and maybe start looking for a patch for our own arrogance, if you ask me. We need to shift our thinking. We need to become much more focused on what people are actually doing or what they're actually trying to do. And we need to explore how we can build our systems, how we can build our applications around them and around their real-world tasks. And I always really like desire trails, like the one you see on the screen, as an analogy for that. The council here, of course, intended that people would take the intended route across the sidewalk to the bus stop that you see in the far distance on the screen. But people being smart, they take the logical, the fastest route straight across the grass. And when enough people start doing that, you start to see these desire trails being formed on the grass. So this is how things work in reality. And yet we in security are like, that is not allowed. You're not supposed to do that. So we put up a sign. And when people are still walking on the grass, we put up a gate. And people might step over it. So we make it higher. And we add a security camera, maybe a guard dog. All aiming for this, you could say, almost imaginary world under the direction of the chief imaginary security officer. And we're so focused on this, on this saying no to everything, that we're essentially steering people away from things. And by doing so, we lose track of what they're trying to achieve. And with that, we lose a lot of their sympathy and of their involvement. And yet we keep wondering why we don't get involved as a department early on. We think a bit, right? Colleagues only come to ask us for permission, for yes and no questions. Can I put my data in the cloud? Yes or no? And it's hardly ever that somebody comes with a question along the lines of, can you help me solve this problem? And yet what we keep doing is just building more and more layers on top of our InfoSec Jenga towers. We add more and more layers of complexity. We have a vendor floor full of them. And we never ever consider taking something away, a good practice that's 15 years old that might not be so good anymore. We don't consider if these things are even the right solution or if we're working on the problem. So how do we patch our own arrogance? One patch I've been banging the drum about quite a bit is the use of checklists. And of course, not audit style checklists. Those are just compliance. That's not security. No, I mean real checklists, like well-designed checklists as like the ones that pilots use. Those are a great mechanism to help skilled operators deal with a complex environment because they allow the operator to essentially offload some of their cognitive load to the checklist. So that's great, but that is something that I think only has its value for us, for the pilots, for the administrators, because a checklist doesn't really scale that well, right? It's quite hard to send out a checklist to all our colleagues or all our customers on how to deal with security. Now, so patch number two is design thinking or human-centered design. Design thinking is a concept that was popularized by IDEO, the design consultancy from the States, and featured quite recently in a Harvard Business Review article as well. And what's design thinking about? Well, at the heart, there's a strong focus on empathy with users, empathy with people. And on top of that, there's a discipline of prototyping. And for those of you familiar with the lean startup or the minimum viable prototype methodologies, it does share some similarities with those approaches. So you have to focus on users early on in the process. You try to understand what it is they're trying to do, what they're trying to achieve, what might hinder them, what might facilitate what they're trying to do, and try to come up with solutions around that. So maybe scary thought, that does actually mean that we will have to get away from our desks and go out and speak to people to try and understand what it is they do in their day jobs. And once we've gained that knowledge, once we learn more about that, we have to define the problem in human-centered terms. So what is a person trying to do instead of what technical problem are we trying to solve? And with that problem definition, you then start brainstorming about potential ways of solutions and build one or more prototypes to test which one might be more effective, rather than assuming you already have the right answer early on. On the topic of empathy and taking the position of your users, I think 2G Tuesdays are a great example. What are 2G Tuesdays? 2G Tuesdays are something that Facebook implemented. Of course, as you know, Facebook's expanding massively, including to countries where network bandwidth, mobile network bandwidth, might not be as good as we're used to here in the US or in Europe. In order for the developers to have a better experience on what it is like to use Facebook on a 2G connection, they have now implemented that whenever employees visit the mobile app on a Tuesday, they get prompted to have their bandwidth throttled to a 2G connection and have almost the same experience as somebody in, let's say, India would have when they are using Facebook. So very powerful way of experiencing what works, what doesn't work too well yet on a slow connection when using the app. Good, maybe as a sidestep here, when I'm saying design, it's good to reiterate that it's not just about how something looks or how it feels. It's not just about an interface. It's also about linking up the digital and the real world. It's especially those areas where design thinking and good design can make a difference. And you see this with all complexities that people are dealing with. They need help making sense of those complexities. They need those interactions with technology to be simple, intuitive, and pleasurable. And in our field, in InfoSec, I don't think a lot has changed since this paper came out in the end of the 90s. I mean, I think Johnny is still sending his private key via email to whoever wants to receive it. Now, every interaction with security, with the teams, with our departments, gives us an opportunity to impress. And that's tools, it's procedures, it's methods, it's the language we use. So I'd encourage you all, think a little bit about what those interactions would look like. And think broad and deep, right? Not just as in, what does a help desk call with our team look like? No, also, how does our software work? How have we worded our policies? How have we worded our error messages? And when you think of those interactions, are they really simple, intuitive, pleasurable? I think a bit more, which interaction with security would manage to put a smile on your colleagues or your customer's face? Still agree we need a patch for human stupidity? Let's move to phishing as an example. We all say phishing is important, right? We are employees or our human sensor network. So we send them on a phishing awareness training so we can tick the awareness box. And that's where we stop. We very often don't think this through from an end-to-end perspective. If I do recognize a phishing email, what do I do? How do I report it? Where do I report it? What do I send? Will I get any feedback on my submission if I was right or not? And is the receiving end even capable of doing anything with my submission? Now, we need to think of a quicker, a more satisfying way to organize this so that users can feel they are actually contributing instead of just receiving an angry phone call from the help desk because they just forwarded the phishing email instead of including header information, whatever that might be from a technical or from an end user perspective. And this is even the real problem. I mean, we spent over 20 years teaching people click on links. If it's blue, if it's underlined, it's a link, you can click it. And now we're starting to unteach people to click on certain links based on vague, hard to understand criteria. And if you ask me, this is a symptom of a problem in InfoSec that we very often offload our problems to our end users. We don't really have our act together, so we put it in the hands of the end users to deal with it. It's similar to what we're doing with password reuse. If we implemented proper crypto, and if we managed to properly protect our password databases or detect attacks before they became breaches, then password reuse should not really have to be a problem. But we don't really have our act together, so we put the responsibility into the hands of the end users to deal with this problem. To make matters worse when it comes to phishing, organizations, especially large ones, send tons and tons of emails that are legitimate, but they look exactly like phishing emails. From an external address, there's links to an external provider you have to give to fill out sensitive information, especially employee awareness campaigns are notorious for this. And the only way we can deal with it is by sending more emails to people who are already receiving dozens and dozens of emails a day. Irony with all this, criminals do this an awful lot better. If you are the victim of a ransomware infection, you get a lot better customer service than you can expect from when you are a normal employee in an organization trying to report phishing to the help desk. I mentioned the PGP paper, 1999. We're not doing an awful lot better. This is how Microsoft Office tries to protect me nowadays when somebody sends me an attachment via email and I want to print it. I want to print, I hit Control P and I get this prompt. I'm in protected view, whatever that may be. It's not really clear what it's protecting me against. It's not really informing me what the risk might be, but it is saying that I want to enable printing. I can click enable printing. Well, I wanted to print the document in the first place, so what do you think I'm going to do? Of course, I'm going to click enable printing. Have we made my system more secure, or did we make printing one click harder? If you ask me, it is the latter. I'd like to move on to some other potential areas of solution, and I'd like to look at some other disciplines as well beyond design thinking as an overarching methodology. A-B testing, I think, is a very powerful one that we should apply more. What is A-B testing? A-B testing is something that's used a lot in online marketing or in science, for that matter. What you do, you essentially give half of your test group one version of an interface, you give half another version, and you test which one does best in whatever the intended effect is, sales, speed, you name it. Facebook applied this when they were testing a new version of their iOS app. They had two busy icons that you see on the screen. One is a new one they had developed, the square with the rectangles. The other is the default iOS spinning icon. And it turned out that the test group, the one that got the new icon, they associated waiting times with Facebook. They were like, Facebook is slow. Whereas the users who had the iOS icon, they associated the waiting times with their phone. So they were like, my phone is slow. Of course, the waiting times were exactly the same. And yeah, it's not really surprising which of the two Facebook chose eventually, the one that associated any waiting times with the phone instead of with them as a service. But this is an extremely powerful concept that we can use a lot in our field as well when we build prototypes, and not just for interfaces or but also for stuff like how do we word a policy? Maybe put two different versions out, see which one the users finds easiest to understand or which one they like best. Don't just drag out that same old good practice that everybody else uses, because a good practice doesn't have to be good for all situations or all companies out there. Another undervalued concept, if you ask me, is the power of defaults. People are very much inclined to stick to a default choice when it's presented to them. They're not so much, whenever they're offered a default choice, they're not willing, you could say, to change to the other option. And what you see on the screen are percentages of organ donors in various countries. And the difference between the green and the red bars is that the green ones, where you have almost 100% people of population registered as an organ donor, they have a system where people are by default registered as an organ donor unless you opt out, unless you write to the government that you don't want to be a donor. Countries, the red ones, they have an opt-in system. You actively have to sign up, I want to be a donor. And you see that far fewer people do that. Their percentages are below 30%. So powerful concept that we can apply as well whenever we are presenting different choices to our users. Great example, by the way, is the way that Google Chrome or iOS are doing automatic updates now. You don't have to actively say when you want to do or if you want to do an update. It's done automatically unless you say you don't want to do the automatic updates. And we can amplify this effect by looking at something that's used a lot online as well, showing what other people have done. We're all, people are herd animals eventually. We like to see what the mass has done. We like to see what the popular group is doing as well. So show what is the most popular option, and you will see that people start to converge towards that option. And that is why you do see screens like this everywhere on the web, wherever there's an option of choosing multiple packages. And we should think incentives. Dan Kaminsky mentioned this as well this morning in his opening keynote. What's in it for me from the perspective of the end user, your colleagues or your customers? And comes back to understanding what it is they're trying to do and try to see if we can ideally align security with that or reward good behavior with somehow tapping into their incentive. So giving some extra storage in the case of Dropbox if you choose a stronger password or enable 2FA, but might also be if you choose a very long password, we're not going to bug you every 90 days that you have to change it. It's those simple things that can help to build this sympathy within the users by aligning what we want to achieve with their incentives as well. And incentives matter from, you could say, a macro ecosystem perspective as well. If you look at the spread in Android versus iOS versions that are out there, that's not just a technical matter, but that is strongly related to ecosystem economics. In the case of Android, the phone manufacturers or the telcos, they don't have any incentive to spend resources on aftercare after they have sold you the subscription or the phone. Whereas Apple, on the other hand, they have a massive financial interest in the whole ecosystem, including the operating system. So they have set up a mechanism where they keep a far more tightly controlled, they have a far more tightly controlled system, including more effective mechanisms to make sure that as many people as possible are on the latest version of the operating system. So also keep your eyes open for factors like these that might be at play in your environments that might not be technical at all. And finally, we have to speak about language. We use an awful, awful, awful lot of jargon in our field, right? And we especially steal or use as much as we can from the military vocabulary. We talk about the cyber kill chains and adversaries and threats, and we go out hunting. And yet we are sometimes this looking so surprised that the business doesn't take us seriously while we sounding like some sort of wannabe James Bond behind a keyboard. Now, we really should simplify our language if we want to be taken more seriously by the people in the real world out there that we're working with. And the app that is shown on the screen is a great resource to give some practical pointers. This was developed by the design agency who developed signage for a lot of airports, including Amsterdam Schiphol Airport. And they give a lot of practical tips on how to help people make sense of stressful travel situations. But there's a lot of similarities to what we're trying to do for people, helping people make sense of complex technical situations. So highly recommended to check this out and see if there's any ways in which you can compare the tips in there with the way we are wording our policies, our tips, our error messages to make our things more simple for normal people to understand. So closing off, we've looked at design thinking, human-centered design in general. We've covered some examples from other disciplines as well that I think we can make use of in our field as well. And what I would really like for all of us to walk out of here is to at least have more open towards these kinds of design challenges. So not just in IT or security, but start to appreciate the art and the skill that's used to make things work. And if you start looking for those examples, it's especially useful to think back of occasions where you started to use something for the first time and it didn't feel quite right. It somehow itched a little bit. Those examples might be situations where you have already adapted, where you have created your own desire path. First time it itched a little bit, second time you started to develop a workaround, by the third time your workaround became common practice and you started to work around and you didn't know any better. But if you can manage to get that itchy feeling back, those might be situations where there's actually a lot of opportunity to improve things with the end user perspective in mind. So if we can get that way of thinking into our minds and then also get a more inclusive and less judging approach towards people paired with this appreciation of good design, I think if we can bring both those elements back to our teams, to our organizations, then we can aim to build security that is so seamless and so simple that it is just there and it just works. And ideally, if we manage to achieve that, hopefully we can start building the security equivalent of the London Tube map instead of those crappy, silly light switches or unusable software like PGP. I think if we manage to achieve that, we are both enabling business, but also making organizations more secure. So by all means, go out, but please take off your security, your technical hats, speak to your colleagues, speak to your customers, and try to walk a mile in their shoes. Thank you very much.